All right, we're going to get started. We got a lot to talk about tonight, and we're going to start off with my guest, who we have Kina Collins. Kina Collins is a nationally recognized gun violence prevention and healthcare advocate running for Illinois' 7th Congressional District seat, which is currently held by Danny Davis, with a proven track record of policymaking, coalition building, and working with communities to improve public health and safety. Kina is ready to represent the needs of the diverse citizens in her district and bring a fresh voice to Washington, D.C. Kina Collins, welcome to the program. Thank you for being here with me.
Thank you for having me. Is this on?
Yeah, no? This is on. Okay. The light is out, but you're on.
Hey, everybody.
Yeah, so, well, I tell you what, why don't you just give everybody a little bit background about Kina, those who don't know all the great work that you've been out there doing. You're in the, I guess you would be considered in the millennial group?
I am in the millennial group,
group. All right, okay, all right.
Yeah.
So just give us a little background.
Sure. So thank you so much for having me on, Mark.
Thank
I know
you.
It's been a long time coming. I've been trying to get on the show even before announcing just the great work that 10 by 10 has been doing in WVON to highlight and elevate the voices of Black Chicago is just phenomenal. So I'm a native of the West Side community, the Austin neighborhood, born and raised.
The awesome West Side.
The GWS, Great West Side.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I'm deeply rooted and entrenched in the Illinois 7th Congressional District. Obviously, my story is a story of many Black Chicagoans. My grandparents came up through that second great wave of migration from the South to the North, settled on the West Side of Chicago. And I come from a strong union household. Both of my parents are union workers and taught me the importance of integrity, hard work, and community being at the core. A lot of my background in organizing work is in gun violence prevention and criminal justice reform work, which I did nationally in both Louisiana and Washington, here in the city of Chicago. And then that kind of led me into healthcare advocacy work, where I organized across the country with 20,000 physicians and medical students fighting to secure a single-payer Medicare for All system, right, to close some of the disparities that we see in Illinois 7th and across the country. In between that time, I helped some really cool progressives get elected into office on the city level, on the statewide level, and in some other cities. And then I wrote my first piece of civil rights legislation, which got passed into law last year in Illinois, called the Illinois Council on Women and Girls Act. So my journey has been both protester, activist, advocate, turned policymaker, right? And I think seeing those equity gaps and disparities in my community and many communities like mine across the country, you know, once I was able to pass my legislation and build that coalition, I decided to throw my hat in the ring for Congress.
Now, you know, we met certainly on the advocacy wave, and you have participated in some of the meetings, and you know that we have been trying to bridge this this gap that I call between the West and the South Side, because
absolutely,
I don't think there's any unique problems there. But I think that we have really sort of a unique strength that if we could really mold that, that we could make a lot of changes for the Black community and strengthen the educational to economic divide here in Chicago and Cook County in the state of Illinois. But I think that beyond that, it could be the example of what we could do around the country.
Absolutely.
And then, as you talked about being an advocate, protester, and policymaker, I think that that's really what demonstrating and protesting is really all about.
Right.
It's not just about getting out making
noise,
but it's about really making a difference. It's bringing awareness to something. Protesting is important, bringing awareness to a particular issue, but also having an objective and a pathway to policies to improve those conditions.
Correct.
And you've really done that very well with a team of people that you put together. You have worked really well and hard to bring people to the city council and and having more, I think there are more millennials running for public office this last time than ever before. And I think that that is a testament to you and your team bringing that platform for those people. And there are a few of them who got into office. I think there were, was it three? millennials that were elected? Well, you know, Jeanette, she's not really a millennial, but Jeanette...
She's a part of the team.
She's a part of the team. She was elected, so we were glad to see her get elected in the 20th Ward. But there was also another younger person who was running there, and then on the north side...
Maria Haddon.
Maria Haddon was elected, and there was another gentleman on the north side. I'm not...
There was Matt Martin, there was Andre Vasquez, there were quite a few people.
Several
people. And, mean, they were mounting the challenge way before, like, I had pulled everybody together. Mm-hmm. And I think it's just, like, their collective. And let me just say, there were, I think, because I was one of the protesters and activists when the Laquan McDonald protest broke out, we saw how we were organizing on the ground, and we needed to transfer that energy to electoral power. Right. Because if we're not bringing the voices to the policy table, then all that we did was just, like, pointless.
Right.
So, really, it wasn't just, like, millennials running. I was surprised that it was just everyday people. And that's what I'm trying to get people to know on the campaign trail that I'm on, that fresh faces and new names doesn't necessarily mean millennial. Like, these fights that we're fighting, my generation is fighting, people have been there and done that.
Right.
We stand on the shoulders of giants. These are intergenerational issues that we have to learn, that we have to lean on the past and what was developed in the past and the groundwork that was laid there. And we have to pick up, pass the baton, and carry the torch. So by no means did I think, you know, when we started, you know, pushing for people to get into city council or any of the work that we've done, whether it's police brutality, state-sanctioned violence, housing, whatever, these are things that have gone on generationally. And they're intergenerational fights. And the only way we cross the finish line is if we do it together.
Well, we have to do it together, but I also think that the people who have come before us, just like the people who came before them, have to realize that the language changes, the lingo changes, and there has to be this inclusiveness. I think that there has been somewhat of a problem that within our community that connectivity to those that are coming behind us has been somewhat disconnected. And I think that this is, it seems to be, and it is a little bit of a challenge, but I think that this is the ripe time for it.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the ripe time for it, because you start to see people like, you know, Alexandria Cortez out in New York, who has really put in a firestorm, right? And really opening up a discussion.
Absolutely.
And sticking to her values, which I'm, you know, I'm really proud of. I know she's upsetting both sides. She's upsetting the Democratic Party, which needs to have an eye-opening and a different look than what they're having. And I think she is going to make a difference, and people like yourself will make a big difference in Congress. People say, well, it's only one vote. No, it's one vote plus about 650,000 people that they represent.
That's
that you need those votes to elect presidents. And, you know, to elect other people. So it's more than just one vote. It is, you know, one vote that represents hundreds of thousands. And I think that that is what she is sending the message to members of Congress, in particular the Speaker of the House. I think that Nancy Pelosi, I think she needs
a
different
approach. Definitely.
Yes.
Well, for me, when I had to interrogate myself before I ran for Congress, you know, because some people would say, well, why would you jump so far to Congress? And it's to the very point that you made, that when we talk about policy, and when I started, when I co-authored House Bill 5544 on the state level, I realized how it has a ripple effect and a butterfly effect across the country, right? Like, we have to write and push forth comprehensive policy, because what's happening outside of Chicago, it's happening in Ferguson, it's happening in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, it's happening in St. Louis, all over. And for me, the fight has never just been Republican and Democrat or left or right. It's been top and bottom. Those at the top who have all the resources and are not giving those resources to us at the bottom. And the concern that I have,
which is what those resources were created for.
Right. And my concern when we don't create a pathway to elevate new leadership is that we argue and fight with each other, which is basically from a scarcity mindset. This idea that we all can't flourish and survive and thrive in the communities that we have. And so we do have to push the status quo. And for me, I think that the Democratic establishment also needs to be called out, right? We should not be slow walking the issues of ending mass incarceration, securing quality health care for everybody, making sure that all children across this country have access to quality education, and that we don't have lead in our water. Like basic human
basic needs. Human needs, right?
Right. Housing, yeah. And water.
Clean,
like, that's
water.
What I'm asking for.
Right, right, right.
So, you know, some people find that controversial. I find that humanity and humane. And if you have a problem with it, it's not just a policy and political issue, it's a moral issue.
Right.
When we still have people in Flint, Michigan who don't have clean water, when we have people here in Chicago who have lead in their water, right? And who is speaking up and who is fighting for us was the question that I had to ask myself. And, you know, we're going to mount the challenge for that.
Well, let's talk about the 7th Congressional District.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I've been very critical, and I am very critical of our representatives, because it is not enough for us to be proud of just having a black face or black person, male or female, in an office.
Right.
We want to support them so that they can be successful. And being successful is bringing back the necessary resources,
yeah,
to make a community strong and give it the foundation that it needs to grow.
Yeah.
If you are not doing that, then you're not being successful.
Yeah.
And we have to ask the question, why? Mm-hmm. Why is that not happening? Is mm-hmm. it something that we're not doing on the ground level? What is it that those things are not happening, that there is this deprivation from education economics,
right,
that you've been that a person has been in office for that long,
mm-hmm.
and we don't have a record that we all could be proud of?
Yeah.
Because what's happening on the west side is, like you say, it's happening all over the country.
That's
in
right.
all of our neighborhoods, those that we know and don't know,
that's right.
Wherever black people are. There are no unique problems for black people in this country.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why government has been opened up and why we wanted to have more people representative of us, because they are supposed to understand what our plight is and to go there to be that voice,
mm-hmm.
And to make it happen, and
yeah.
bring back those resources to make it happen. What do you think are the problems that you see, as you see, in terms of the lack of representation in the 7th Congressional District?
Yeah, well, let me just say that Congressman Davis has been my congressman practically my whole life.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm 28, he's been in office for 22 years. And like I said, I was born in Austin, I was raised in Austin. When I win the seat in 2020, I'm gonna stay in Austin,
mm-hmm.
because I think that those who are closest to the pain need to be closest to the power,
mm-hmm.
right, when we're talking about that. For me, I think we have such a diverse, Illinois 7th Congressional District is essentially a microcosm of America. We have the most diverse district in Illinois. It's the fifth most Democratic district in the country. And so the pendulum swings from racial diversity to religious diversity, and most specifically economic diversity. And so what I'm seeing in the district is that neighborhoods like Austin, North Lawndale, East Garfield Park, which are all in the district, Inglewood, Back of the Yards, Bronzeville, which is all in the district, we are deteriorating, right? Not just entire neighborhoods of abandoned buildings, but now we have abandoned schools. When we look at the statistics, healthcare-wise, there's a healthcare equity disparity in Illinois 7th. Streeterville, which is a more white and affluent and economically affluent area, has the average age of 90. But if you travel 10 miles south to Inglewood, the average age of life expectancy is 60. It's 30 years of life expectancy just based off of the zip code.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not right to me, right? So it's healthcare, it's the lack of housing that is becoming pervasive in the Illinois 7th Congressional District, and the fact that we need to decriminalize poverty. So 44% of residents in Illinois 7th that are under the age of 18 are living in poverty, and 25% of our families are. And there's not really a real plan on how do we bring in federal assistance to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So once again, I would never say anything disparaging about the congressman. He's had a long and distinguished career, and I think anybody who would like to argue that differently, you know, would be a bit naive to say that. And he's very entrenched in the district and in other places. But once again, it goes back to being in touch with what is currently happening and having a sense of urgency to get or fix the crisis that is happening for Black and brown communities and working class communities in the district.
What is it that you see that there has not been a greater growth? Somebody who's been in office for 22 years, and I know Congressman Davis, he's been in office 22 years, but prior to that he was a an
City
alderman.
Councilman.
And so he's been there and a commissioner. So what is it that you think is the greatest challenge for bringing growth there that you would have as a congresswoman? How do you see that happening? Because obviously you have to get support to bring about the difference, right, of those things that we see that are there that that's stagnant in our community.
Absolutely.
How do you make that different?
I think that there need to be several the number one thing that in the core of what has worked in any organizing that I've done, whether it's been statewide or it's been on the city level, is that you need to bring those who are being impacted by what you're trying to fix. Their voice needs to take precedent at the table. And unfortunately, we haven't seen a lot of that. When policy is created, and I've been there, I've been in committee rooms for law that's getting called to the House floor. I've been in community meetings where certain demographics of people get cut out of the conversation, and they're the ones who need the assistance most, right? We're not taking more of a community solution-centered kind of approach to these issues. And once again, it's that out of touch, you know, let's do what we've always done that has caused the stagnant energy across the district, and not just across the district, but across the country. So for me, I think it's elevating the voices of folks that are working class, you know, protecting the rights of things like unions, which we just don't make a big conversation anymore. You know, when the unions stopped showing up and voting for Democrats, we should have known that there was a problem, right, that was happening. So protecting workers' rights and things like that. I just don't see a diversity of voice when we're shaping policy. And that's not just to say that we should do that so that we're being diverse, but we should be doing that because it informs policy and it creates comprehensive solutions. So it's getting out there, rolling up your sleeves and getting on the corner and talking to some of these young men. It's providing, you know, access to young girls who oftentimes don't see themselves standing in front of the room and leading. It's going to the disability community and saying, what do you need us to put into the healthcare bills, right? We're just not doing that.
You said something earlier that in the conversation about decriminalizing poverty, and I think that and on many levels we have criminalized, and you don't even hear poverty talked about by anyone,
right?
In terms of a person who is in a public office, you hear middle class, you know, that sort of thing,
right?
But you don't hear about people who are impoverished, and people, we hear about crime, right? When they want to talk about people who are poor, they want to talk about crime. They want to call people, label them certain names so they can dismiss them,
and,
you know, basically say that they don't count or they don't matter. What will be your message of a constant to keep that prevalent in Congress, so that conversation is prevalent? Because it is frustrating that on any level, in particular, you know, when we talk about from our communities, that you don't hear people talking about the poor.
You know, I think it's less about what I would say and more about who am I bringing to do the talking for on behalf of our district and on behalf of those populations. Sometimes, and unfortunately, a lot of representatives haven't taken this approach, which is why I think Congresswoman Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Congresswoman Ayanna Pressley out of Massachusetts have been really successful at is that they let these organizations and these groups and these activists on the ground do the speaking. You know, the first week that AOC was elected, there was the Sunrise Movement sitting in Nancy Pelosi's office, occupying the office, saying, we need you to talk about climate change. And, you know, once you understand that you are a part of the collective and you are the representative of the people in your district, in order to be a strong representative, I feel like you need to be a follower and hear what's the pulse and the temperature of what's happening on the ground and what's the needs. And I think it's also a shock value when you bring people in the room to speak on behalf of these issues who they don't consider the experts on these things. Well,
and who's more expert than somebody who's living it?
Listen, I've been living in Austin 22 years of my life. I mean, 28 years of my life. I am an expert of my community. You can't tell me what Austin needs because I'm there every single day. And that's how we have to take the approach with constituents and voters. We have to put the power back into their voice, into their votes, and into the mobilizing, right? And so changing the narrative of what an expert looks like. Because a lot of, you know, what we see or what they deem as criminal or youth that are criminal, these kids have better solutions to some of the answers to gun violence and school shootings and climate change than even I have, right? And so I would really use my platform to uplift and elevate those voices and
like a really good paying job as opposed to a social program.
Right.
Talking with Kina Collins. She is the candidate for the 7th Congressional District. When we come back, we'll continue our conversation and we'll take some phone calls at 312-374-8130. We'll be back in just a moment.
More with Mark Wallace up next on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Thank you, Chicago. Because of you, the Taste of WVON is now one of the biggest outdoor festivals in Chicago. So big, we've moved to the grounds of Chicago State University, 9500 South King Drive. It's really big, with over 100 local retail and food vendors, a children's pavilion and seniors pavilions, and a whole lot of great music featuring Chicago's own Simone Green, the soulful Avery Sunshine. Indiana. Help us welcome your homegirl, Denise Williams.
There's nothing better that I like to do.
Denise Williams. And headlining the Wintrust soundstage.
I am the light.
It's the queen of hip hop, MC Light.
I get exotic with the melodic. Tune, I get hypnotic with the moon, but you got to put me down.
And Atlantic Star. Atlantic Star.
I'm just a telephone call away.
Now that's big. The Taste of WVON is free, but this year we're adding limited preferred seating for $20. Visit thetasteofwvon.com for all the details. The Taste of WVON.
It's the community's family reunion.
Saturday, July 20th, on the grounds of Chicago State University, 9500 South King Drive. It's 168 acres of party. It's family, it's fun, it's flair, and it's free.
It'll be a party, y'all.
WVON lineup, chat room, blogs, photos, podcasts, and more on the World Wide Web at WVON.com.
Welcome back to the program. I'm Mark Wallace, your host and facilitator. Kina Collins is my guest, and she is a candidate for the 7th Congressional District, which spreads from the west side all the way to the east side and to the south side.
Yeah.
So, you know.
And western suburbs.
And the western suburbs.
The provisos, that's Maywood, Bellwood, Oak Park, River Forest, Westchester, Berwyn.
So, and that's about 650,000 people.
700,000.
700,000. Over 700,000.
Yeah.
So it's a larger district than most.
Yeah, but we've been seeing a huge exodus of black folks, as we know, in Illinois, who have been leaving places like Austin and Inglewood and have been moving out of the district. So we've definitely taken a hit with folks who've been leaving because of lack of investment and opportunities, et cetera.
Yeah. Right. And one of the things that I think that I don't hear and I want to see happening is that there be a real emphasis on creating economic strength for impoverished people.
Yep.
These are people who are not going to college. Mm-hmm. These are people who have some other challenges. But when I believe that if we can spend $3 billion a year investigating and prosecuting the same people, that we could take half of that and invest it in these people, and I think that we wouldn't have to spend the other half on doing that, because I think that, you know, the whole thing, you know, I think that should be a hashtag decriminalizing poverty. But that we spend that kind of money on investigations, incarcerations,
that's right,
and doing it over and over and over again.
Yep, we have to look at the recidivism rate. People go right back.
They go right back
to
in.
Jail. Yeah.
But when you find that people can have a good paying job, a really good paying job, you know, I don't think that anybody should be working a job earning less than $50,000 to $100,000 a year. It's possible. Mm-hmm. This is not things that are impossible.
Yep.
It is possible for us to do this if we have the will to do it.
Yep.
It's been done before. And I was speaking with you about that off off air, that we're going to be bringing the gentleman in next week who did that in the poorest region in the poorest state in the country, brought in $6 billion worth of industry that took an unemployment from 20% to just over the national average in 10 years. That's the real work.
That's the work
that we need to be doing. And I believe investing in people as opposed to investing on people is not something that we've done very well in poor communities.
A lot of my like economic plan that I want to bring, and I'm like super excited about it, because I, like I said, being from Austin or the west side of Chicago, you are really the economically, politically forgotten portion of the city of Chicago. I always tell people this, the south side deals with the same issues we do, but we don't have a DuSable. We don't have a University of Chicago, and that's not to say the University of Chicago is nice to the south side of Chicago or the poor working class communities, but we don't have a Chicago State either. We don't have those kinds of things on the west side of Chicago, and how do we make it for both, right? Like, how do we make it for both? And one of the ways that I really want to focus on the youth in these areas is saying that, yes, we need trades and vocations, et cetera, but we need to also tap into this multi-billion dollar green energy kind of sector, where we could be teaching students how to build solar panels. We could be training groups of working class people how to participate in clean energy and making Illinois 7th a green district, right? Because it's not only just sustainable for our environment, but it's fiscally responsible. And those are the kind of grants and things that I would hope to usher into the Illinois 7th Congressional District to spearhead projects like that.
How will you break into, because obviously you have to work with your local representatives here.
Mm-hmm.
And because things are so politicized, how do you break that?
You mean as far as Democrats or Republicans or
politicized, period? Here in, obviously in Chicago and in the state of Illinois, it's heavily Democratic, right? But how do you break down that politicizing things to actually getting them to do the real work?
Yeah, that actually happened when I wrote my bill. When I wrote co-authored my bill, I had to travel to red districts, blue districts in the state. I actually traveled to 68 out of 102 counties in Illinois. Mm-hmm. And some of the areas were rural, and they were agricultural workers, and some places were super suburban, and other places were metropolitan cities. And really the truth is, many communities want the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, so you can't be reliant on one person in the Democratic Party or Republican Party to push and spearhead these things through. Right. Once again, it goes back to the collective. The people in these communities have so much power, but we disengage them from the electoral work so that the power is consolidated to one group of people who continuously get elected, mm-hmm. election after election. And so for me, it is being a coalition builder. It's being somebody who can listen to both sides, but be uncompromising about progressive values and things that benefit those, the least of these in society, right? So for me, it's utilizing and tapping into the organizing one-on-one, because at my heart, that's what I am, an organizer. Mm-hmm. And in order for you to be an effective organizer, you have to be a coalition builder. And oftentimes people see everyday normal people, they see that when you work together, you accomplish far more, right? So that narrative, this idea that people don't know how to work together is like, that's propaganda, mm-hmm. because majority mm-hmm. of people do want to work together. Right. But it becomes politicized. It becomes negative sometimes. And so for me, it's any representative, any elected official, if you're not a coalition builder, if you're not trying to bring the community together in these difficult times, then, you know, what are you doing?
Right. Yeah, I think that any representative that says that they're not willing to work with another representative,
yeah,
you have to question their the authenticity of why they're there.
Why, right? You got to question the motives.
Right,
you
got to question the motives. I always say to when in our meetings, you know, check your motives. Mm-hmm. Always check your motives before you go into. So let's talk about what are some of your progressive ideas? Because everybody's progressive ideas are different.
Yeah.
Right. Some things that some people think that are progressive, you know, I see them as regressive. Mm-hmm. But what are some of your ideas of what's progressive?
Yeah. So for me, it breaks down to three things in the Illinois 7 that we would immediately have to work on. So that's healthcare, that's criminal justice reform, and it's gun violence prevention. So because I'm an organizer for gun violence prevention, I think that we need to write comprehensive policy around gun laws.
What would that look like?
That would look like in Illinois, our laws are not that bad around guns. However, when you look at states like Indiana, Wisconsin, et cetera, they have looser gun laws. So a lot of guns into Illinois are coming from out of state.
So we need to have some sort of federal legislation,
yeah,
that we're all, you know, have to live by?
Yep. You need federal legislation that requires and puts sanctions on gun manufacturers, gun shops, et cetera. Just because if it could be applicable to Illinois, but if it's not to Indiana, Wisconsin, and those kind of states, then it could just flow right into ours. And that includes things like universal background checks. I think that people should have universal background checks when you are getting a gun. As a matter of fact, my stance is that we should raise the federal age to purchasing a gun to 21. I think that gun shops in particular should have some form of accountability. Like in Florida, for example, you don't need a license even to get a gun, to buy a gun. You can walk into a gun shop and just like buy a gun. And we know that has turned out horrific for communities, for schools, for public spaces, mm-hmm. right? So we have to have a real conversation on how do we strike at the root. Because we're the only developed country that deals with gun violence like this. We saw what happened in New Zealand, and 10 days later, they had a ban on assault rifles. Mm-hmm. And so we're not taking it serious. And I don't think that it's cool that you can't go to church, you can't go to school, you can't go to the movie theater.
And not feel safe.
Mm-hmm. And not feel safe. I think also pushing the voices of Black and brown people to the forefront of that conversation as well, because we deal with it daily. We oftentimes see when mass shootings happen, season, it gets a lot of national attention and they get resources. Right. Whereas we deal with mass shootings every weekend and no one says anything.
Right.
There's a lot of conversation on the federal level about the city of Chicago and what does the government need to do about the city of Chicago and the gun crisis here. Number one, we're not even in the top 10 most dangerous cities in the country per capita.
Right.
But number two, the way that they want to attack the issue and the problem is criminalizing it. It's
right.
bringing in the National Guard and things like that. That's not going to stop violence.
Right.
We need jobs. We need after-school programming. We need trauma-informed care, investing in how do we get people in these neighborhoods to be healed from PTSD, anxiety, depression, from the kind of, you know, gun violence we deal with. So I, as you can see, I'm pretty passionate about that.
Mm-hmm.
Healthcare is, I believe, in a single-payer Medicare for all system, which essentially means that everyone in our country should have full access to quality healthcare. We should not be strapped down by copays, deductibles, premiums, and high prescription costs. Because in our community, as you know, there's many social determinants that deteriorate our health. So whether it's not having fresh produce, whether it's dealing with gun violence, whether it's not having adequate housing, we need a complete overhaul on how we get access to healthcare. And then finally, I think, you know, criminal justice reform. We have things in our district called million-dollar blocks, which means
yes.
that the government has spent, whether it's on the state level, the county level, or federal level, $1 million per block to incarcerate people in our communities. And
I've read that study.
And it's ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
And it amounts to about $100 million a year.
Yes.
Our district also houses what they call Heroin Highway off of 290. It's one of the largest heroin or opioid corridors in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And so looking at things like addiction, for example, and saying that we don't need to make that punitive and throw more people in jail, we need to be rehabilitating people. We need to be investing in preventative care and treatment, and not just incarcerating people for nonviolent offenses. Like, it's just a waste of our money. It's not fiscally responsible when you really look at it.
Yeah, that is what I call criminalizing, and I'm sure you
decriminalizing
do call,
poverty.
Criminalizing poverty, and it is... And my opinion, it's intentional.
Absolutely.
To do that, because if
the
you
system
can take,
is working.
Oh,
like,
it's, yeah, it's working. It's absolutely working.
It's working,
right?
For the way it was designed.
And
yeah.
It also works when you invest in people.
That's right.
When you finally decide to invest in people, that also works.
Yeah.
I was watching some program, and I can't remember the name of it now, a few weeks ago, where they had men who had committed some of the most heinous crimes in, they were in Rikers Islands.
Mm-hmm.
They decided to educate these men.
Wow.
And, you know, these are men who would still be coming out. They served long sentences.
Right.
But every one of them went and got a college education, right?
Yeah.
And they are all coming back to their communities to work in their communities.
Report back.
As college-educated men.
Men.
And so when you invest in people,
yep.
they'll be more productive.
Yeah, because when we say criminal justice reform, like, what does that mean? For me, that means things like banning the box, which
right.
means when people fill out applications for school or work opportunities, if they've done their time, why do you need to know, you know, what it just puts them at a disadvantage,
right?
It means things like, in our community, the nonviolent offenses that people, particularly young black and brown men, get arrested for is drug offenses, right? That means that they can't get a federally subsidized student loan to go to college so that they can do better for themselves and their communities.
Mm-hmm.
So it means stripping them of their voting rights, right? We saw this huge push in the midterm in Florida, 1.2 million people getting reinstated their voting rights because the community and the state spoke. And so once people go through the process, the criminal justice system, we should be trying to rehabilitate. We
mm-hmm.
should not be still punishing people once they get out and they're trying to do better for themselves.
I actually don't think that people should ever lose their voting rights.
Right.
Because even when you're in a prison, you have to act, you know, you have to acquiesce to whatever those requirements are, which are required by law.
That's right.
And I think that just because a person has been convicted of a crime doesn't mean that they should lose, you know, their rights to vote. I just disagree with that.
I mean, it's essentially steering the country in the direction that we're going in. And if you are living in America and you don't have a say in the direction that this country should go in, then you are a prisoner eternally, right? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's my stance too. I also believe in reinstating, I mean, that you shouldn't have your voting rights stripped.
Right. All right, let's take some phone calls. All right. If you have a question for our guest, our guest is Kina Collins. She is the candidate for the 7th Congressional District. And we're going to take some of your phone calls for the 12 minutes that we have left. And this hour that has gone by so fast. We're going to start with you, Thel. Thel, welcome to the program. You have a question for our guest. Hey, Thel. Is Thel there?
Hey.
Thel. Thel is gone. Let's go to Robert. Robert, welcome to the program.
Hello. Good evening. How you doing?
Good. How you doing?
Hello.
Good evening.
Oh, Mark, this is Robert. How you doing, Representative? What's your name?
Kina Collins. Yes.
Who are you running against?
Congressman Danny K. Davis in Illinois 7.
Oh, wow. Well, I thought you were running against Mr. Bobby Rush. But anyway, I have some ideas for you if you want to listen. You know, and take a page out of Lost Nevada. You know, they have a program what they call the Sheriff Card where they can put ex-cons back to work.
Wow.
That means the sheriff or whoever got all the information on these guys and ladies, and that they can come back to work. And they can take, I think, about 50-some jobs or more in Illinois where so ex-con can't work, right?
Mm-hmm.
They have a job. You have an idea about like that so they can get the sheriff to get more information on them. They can get back to regular job like everybody else. We're working Las Vegas, you know?
Right.
Okay, Robert, thanks.
You talk about that? Get the sheriff to get more information on them. They can get back to regular job like everybody else. We're working Las Vegas, you know?
Right.
Okay, Robert, thanks.
You talk about that?
I guess his question is, because we got to move it along, I guess his question is you know, what would Robert be for helping people who have had convictions get back to
Absolutely. Work? So we need to have a diversity of things for them to do, right? Because whether it's going back to school or being in the workforce or even a lot of people find this controversial, which I don't understand, is teaching entrepreneurship, right? In order for us to close this wealth equity gap that we have in the country, because we know that black and brown folks are disproportionately locked up in prison, we have to make the options a variety of things for what people want to do. And the more passionate you are about doing something, the more willing you are to pour back into your community. So I'm definitely for that. Definitely job and workforce equity, school and education, and entrepreneurship.
You would have to build a coalition obviously you're going to build a coalition in your district.
Yeah.
But I also think that you'd have to build a coalition in Congress with people who share
those
values to bring that voice even to Congress to really start talking about these things.
The good news is that the groundswell is there.
I think it is.
It is a diverse
last
midterm.
Is right.
It was very diverse.
Yeah, the time is right. All right, let's Thel is back. Let's go to Thel. We're going to try to get Thel on. Thel, you got a question?
Yes, a comment. First, I want to thank you for the respect that you showed Danny. Mm-hmm. You covered a lot of mileage by doing that, young lady.
Thank you.
I really appreciate that. You were talking about the progressive policy.
I'm sorry, this is Thel, right?
Yes,
okay.
It's Thel.
All right, Thel. They had Thel up. Okay, so I just want to make sure we're talking to the right person. Thel. We're talking about Thel. Go right ahead, Thel.
Thank you very much. Right. Years ago, the Nation of Islam was hired by the Public Housing Authority to come in and serve as security over some of our developments. It changed the whole complexion of that immediate community.
Mm-hmm.
but the rug was pulled from underneath them for a reason that we all know and feel as though it was, you know, to be racism. In your policy, do you see being able to affect that type of a contribution to us by identifying folk who are willing to go beyond the call of duty to bring about some type of sanity in our community, like the Nation of Islam? The other is that with cleaning up a community, which is my bailiwick, my mission, my responsibility to our community, I feel nothing is going to be successful. And all the things that you said that you want to address, education, housing, economic development, can't be done without having a clean environment.
Yes.
Along with the Black Star Project, we're moving to invite the mayor in a very, very respectful but demanding way that she go on a filth tour with us to point out some obvious things that we don't have to tolerate in our community. You said something about strike at the root.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Francis Cress Welsing said back in the 80s that we as a people have a high tolerance for filth, and we do. And that filth is at the root of many of our social ills. I am very familiar with Austin. I cut my teeth on community programs back in the 70s.
All right, we've got to get to the question, Sal, because we're running out of time.
It was more of an opportunity to make a statement. I appreciate your energy, but I do want to know and understand. I love and respect Annie Davis, but I'm willing to hear what it is that you're trying to do and say.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, Sal, thanks.
Yeah, I definitely think that he brings up a great point. I think that it through one train ride through Illinois 7th Congressional District, you can see the physical manifestation difference. And it really shows where the priority is. And once again, we don't just have entire neighborhoods of abandoned buildings, but now abandoned schools. What does that say to the kid growing up on the west sides or south sides of the city of Chicago or any working class community when there's not even an investment in education, right? So that is such a top priority. And I mean, I can't stress it enough. We cannot slow walk this environmental crisis that we are under. Lead in the water, toxins in the air, not having fresh produce, not investing in eliminating carbon emission, it is going to be the detriment of future generations of this country. So I definitely agree with that.
Yeah, it has to be a radical approach. Mazar, you're going to be the last caller. Mazar, welcome to the program.
Yes, sir. Thank you. And welcome to your guest. I'm fully supportive of what she's doing. I hope her campaign wins. Danny Davis, he's been there all this time, and what he has to show for it is minuscule. And her projection of what she intends to do already has exceeded what he has not done. So I'm so thankful and that she will keep up the fight, and I support her. And Danny Davis, he just runs on his name, and that's it.
Okay.
Nothing to show. Even I've had people who have went to his office and did not get help from him. Mm. So, you know, he's a facade.
All right,
and
well,
I just appreciate the young lady that's running against him, and I give her full support of people who ever I will speak to. In that Austin area and the south suburbs and the south side, I know they gerrymandered it all crazy,
right.
But
okay,
still.
Mazar. All right, very good. Thank you so much. There's a lot of frustration out there.
Yeah, it's a lot of frustration out there. You know, we are in a time, and I think that people look at the Trump America. When we look back in history, we'll look at this time. And what I say to voters is that this can be our darkest hour or our finest. And I think it's our finest hour because it is motivating so many of us to get up and become active. And that's kind of the interaction I've had with voters,
right,
is that they're ready for change. They say it's time.
Well,
so.
I think that if there's any one good thing that has come out of a Trump's presidency, is it that we all know and understand that elections have consequences.
That's right.
To them.
Elections, you just hit it on the head. We can end it right there.
Right, they have serious consequences to them, and they impact us all across the board. Even, you know, the our local election that we had here with electing Bruce Rauner, where now as taxpayers are going to have to cough up another $1.2 billion just in interest payments because of
his lack of leadership.
The lack of leadership and deciding not to to pay bills. I mean, these things, it doesn't go away. It just gets more expensive for us to do it. And who we have to pay it. And certainly not him. People that is from that that little sector. So they do have serious consequences. But elections can have real benefits as well. And I think that I think that these elections have really opened the eyes of people who were either on the fence or people who were not really paying attention at all, that they have become really, really attentive to what's going on and active. And I really look forward to that. And I think that it's showing up at the ballot box. It's really showing up at the ballot boxes because we're seeing people who are not the traditional experts as
the candidates,
right?
Right.
The candidates, that are coming in and bringing the voice of people who are at the ground
so
level.
Thank you so much for having me. Anybody who's listening, please check out KinaForCongress.com. We start door knocking soon. And I mean, I've been speaking to constituents and voters across the district for the last 2 years. And we're really just excited to A, mount this challenge, but B, bring a lot of these issues and call them to the carpet. Things that have not been talked about in a really long time. And obviously through a different lens, right? So it's going to be exciting.
Well, I think that that I can truly say, and that people will find out, there is someone to vote for as opposed to voting against. And so all the best to you.
Thanks so much
for coming.
Thank you so much.
We'll be talking again. Kina Collins, 7th Congressional District candidate for Congress. We'll be back in a moment.